WWE Raw tickets. Mary is live in San Diego today. It's fine. I mean, it's you know, take a little while to get used to, and no, it's fine. It's better than not hearing you at all. I didn't mean it like that. I meant signal strength, Bill. Bill knows what I mean. Signal strength.
You used the wrong tone. You sounded
I did, didn't I?
Yeah, you used a caring tone, and that's what you get.
Did I?
Way to go.
Did I, Bill?
Yeah.
Did I use a care? Is it really? Cavaliers are off tonight. They're back at home tomorrow to play the Thunder of Oklahoma City. Is Oklahoma City, like, is that a good fan base?
Yeah.
The Oklahoma Cityans love the Thunder?
Yeah, because it's all they have.
Right. They don't have baseball or football.
No, I mean, they have college football.
The state doesn't have.
Yeah, they have I don't even know where the Sooners are, but I know they, in Oklahoma, that's the team.
Yeah,
and then Oklahoma State University has a pretty good fan base too. But when it comes to professional sports, all they got is the Thunder. The reason they ended up getting that franchise is when Hurricane Katrina happened, the Hornets played most of their season, I think maybe their whole season, in Oklahoma City, and people were showing up and going crazy for this team. So they're like, oh, these people want some sort of franchise. So then Seattle was in a situation where they weren't getting a stadium, so they go, all right, let's move them. And they moved Seattle Supersonics to Oklahoma City, and they've been pretty supportive. And they haven't been as good of a franchise late. I mean, obviously, they started off really strong having Kevin Durant and Russell Westbrook and James Harden, so they were a really good team for a while. And then they've had some up and down years, but they still, I feel like, have a pretty good fan base that shows up, and they have this whole thing where they don't sit down at the game until, I don't know if they're still doing that, but I think they do, where they don't sit down until the home team makes their first shot.
Really?
So, yeah.
You don't sit down until the home team makes a shot.
Yeah. As opposed to
standing on their hands, because it's harder to clap with your feet. Then you wedge your head in there in the bleachers.
That's ableist.
I have never been to Oklahoma. I've never been to...
I feel like I've just driven through there.
I haven't even driven through. Well, there's a reason to go anywhere. I mean, it's beautiful, like Indian land all throughout Oklahoma, like Choctaw Nation and Cherokee Nation, and you know. But I've never been through Oklahoma. I had a buddy that went to Creighton, which I think is in Omaha. So I've been to Omaha, but that's not in Oklahoma. That is in Nebraska. That's what I'm saying.
They call Nebraska the Oklahoma of the a little bit more to the northwest.
I've never driven across the country. So these are a lot of these places I think people visit if they make one of those drives.
Yeah, I've driven across the country a few times to L.A. and to just Arizona and stuff like that. So we drove through it, but I don't remember spending a significant amount of time in any of the cities or anything like that. So I don't really count that.
By the way, Major League Baseball has also killed that Expos-Rays thing, too.
I mean, done?
Yeah, the Rays were going to split seasons in Montreal. They were going to kind of, I shouldn't say Expos, but weren't they going to try to do...
They were going to do a sister city thing with the Rays. Yeah.
Yep. And so MLB goes, nope. So they're not sure what's going to happen with the Tampa Bay Rays. I know there were a lot of people in...
Oklahoma City!
There are a lot of people in Tampa who were like, you know... we don't want to do anything with Montreal, blah, blah, blah. But the Rob Manfred, who is the Major League Baseball commissioner, informed the owners of the Tampa Bay Rays that they rejected their plan.
That would have
And the
to
team
be...
had been working on this for a while, so I think they were surprised and pissed.
I feel like that's, you know, me not being a paperwork guy, I feel like if you have a team that has a sister city that's not even in the same country... I mean, it sucks when we have to do our taxes and you get a W-2 from another state and you have to go and file those state taxes. Going international like that, that's got to be a nightmare to deal with.
Yeah.
So they're saving themselves some paperwork, which I'm all for.
Well, I assumed that perhaps they had consulted with you on that.
They didn't.
But the team worked on this for a while, and I think they consider this having the rug pulled out from under them.
Yeah. But they're snow stingrays.
Boy, you do not want to get stung by a Montreal Ray. You just don't. No, they have Raymonds in Montreal. They don't have stingrays. They don't have snow rays. They have a lot of Raymonds.
Hey, I'm from Montreal, eh?
There you go. And not Ray Montreal, not the Netherlands guy, not the DJ from the Netherlands. We all know him. Listen, more importantly, they are starting to work automated robot umpires into AAA baseball. And I, for one, cannot wait to welcome our home plate overlords.
Now, here's my question. Is there an actual robot, or do they just have cameras and equipment that are making these decisions? Because I would like to have a robot behind the players that goes, ball, strike.
That's what I ball, want, too.
Strike.
But I have a feeling it's going to be more boring than that. Yeah. Why do you mean, like the manager runs out and starts screaming at the robot? Yeah. That would be fun.
Right, yeah.
Get the F out of my face.
You are ejected.
You are out.
Does not compute.
A huge arm comes out of the body of the robot and just punches this old manager in the face.
With a big boxing glove.
Yeah, big boxing glove.
See, they don't consult us on this stuff.
Well, that's all function, and we're talking fashion.
Right.
But I think it should be a meld. The best technology melds the two.
Mm-hmm.
The best technology is a combination of form and function. And if they're just going to have a box because they don't want to pay umpires, home plate robot umpires are going to be worked into AAA, courtesy of automated ball and strike systems. They're going to be operating them for the Albuquerque Isotopes, go Topes.
Hang on with those hats.
The Charlotte Knights, the El Paso Chihuahuas, Las Vegas, Oklahoma, Reno, Sacramento, a whole bunch of other. The Sugar Land Skeeters. I assume that's a Texas team. And so far, not the Akron Rubber Ducks. So far, they are still going to have human umps.
Can we at least dress the human umps up like robots? So they have, like they look very much like the old robots from 50s movies, where it's just the coil arms.
That's like Robbie the Robot from Lost in Space.
Yeah, or something like that.
Danger, balls and strikes. Or Woody Allen in Sleeper. Just like it looks like a person, but they got this plug in their mouth. And so I really hope that they figure out a way to make this. You know, like in Japan, they have restaurants that operate solely by robot waiters.
They do?
There's a place. Yeah. They'll slide up with a cart. We went to this hibachi joint in Westlake over Thanksgiving last year, and they have one of those robot cocktail waitresses that slides around with a tray. It didn't come to our table.
That's like from Star Wars.
That's what I'm saying.
That's, yeah. Return of the Jedi, really.
Really, yeah, when you think about it.
Well, I mean, that's what... Where they're at Jabba's palace, and they're watching everybody get thrown into the Sarlacc pit. Everyone's really interested in this. There's a
nerd alert. Nerd alert.
R2-D2 is serving drinks.
Yeah.
Robots.
So I hope that they can figure out a way to make us less or make us more enthused about robot umpires. And it's probably in their continuing efforts to get fans to act like civilized people, too. Because you can't go, this ump sucks. He can't see anything. Or you're working with a machine that's got laser eyes and, you know, working up, crunching data. You might think that it takes some of the humanity out of the game, but guess what? There's some pretty broken humanity out there in the stands. And that's no fun.
Just one last quick thing on Star Wars. Do you know the name of
Nerd Alert!
Jabba's pet that kept doing the weird, like, laugh, like the Poundcake laugh, basically.
The Poundcake laugh? Yeah. It was like a little thing with Salacious Crumb.
Very good.
I had the card, the Empire cards, Jedi cards.
Salacious B. Crumb.
Okay. What did the B stand for? Salacious Beatrice Crumb?
I don't know
if you
know what the B stands for.
I didn't even know that there was a
What does
B?
The B in Salacious?
Because it was supposed to be
a
monkey
B with
lizard.
A period.
Yeah. All right.
Body. The B stands for body. Salacious body crumb.
B-A-W-D-Y?
Yeah.
Body?
Yeah.
Kind of, yeah, or a little lascivious, or, you know, kind of loose, yeah, bawdy. Like,
this is the guest, yeah.
Salacious bawdy crumb. All right. All right.
Sounded bawdy earlier on the show.
Isn't he the one that pulls out C-3PO's eyes?
Yeah.
And he's like, I can't see! That's my C-3PO. That's my Anthony Daniels impression.
Very good.
I can't see, Governor! It's my C-3PO.
You've ever said Governor ever.
Oh, boy. Yeah. So, Salacious Crumb.
Salacious B. Crumb.
Salacious B. Crumb.
Bawdy Crumb.
And then, who was the other one I remember from? Bib Fortuna.
Bib Fortuna
was the dude, like the consigliere.
Yeah,
with
that had like the big neck wrap thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They got Jennifer Beals, by the way, in Boba Fett doing that. She's the Twi'lek is what they're called. Mm-hmm. And she looks super hot, but I'm bailing on Boba Fett. I'm out. I'm not sticking with it.
I watched two episodes. I got two to catch up on. I'll do it, but I'm not in. It's not like Peacemaker. Peacemaker, I'm like super excited.
I just started that.
It's so fun. And I really, like, the whole cast is great. The music's fun. It's a lot of, like, 80s hair metal stuff. It's a fun show.
Hello, Earth Boy. It's me, Short Circuit.
Just go away.
Beep, bop, boop. Beep, bop, boop.
There you go, right there at home plate.
That's what I want.
Beep, bop, boop.
One beep for a ball, two beeps for a strike.
That's right.
Can you
Yep. And then Jeff Garland will call you a whore and everybody will go home. What's that?
You got to reboot the umpire.
That's why they need to recreate that with the robot.
Yeah, but I'm sure there's plenty of people that are like, well, who is the guy that almost had the perfect game? And I think it was against the Indians.
Doc Ellis.
No. He had a no-hitter, but he was on LSD.
Oh, right, yeah.
But he had, like, 11 walks. No, there was a guy that he almost had a perfect game, and the umpire made a bad call at first base and completely screwed up the first. It was a terrible call.
It was Doug.
Was it Doug?
Yeah, okay. It was Doug. Is who she's thinking
Doug
of.
B. Doug.
Doug B. Doug.
For Doug Buddy.
Armando Galarraga is the guy you're thinking
That's
of.
That's the guy.
Yeah. It was the Detroit Tigers.
Mm-hmm.
I got to give you some money here. It's $1,000 for GoFund yourself. So listen closely and good luck.
The Buzzard wants you to GoFund yourself and score $1,000. Enter the nationwide keyword deposit at WMMS.com. That's deposit. Enter it now at WMMS.com. And good luck from Buzzard Radio.
Alan Cox Show After Hours line. Anytime you want to leave us a message there, you can. It's 216-986-8903.
Hey, Alan. This is Andrew from Detroit. In October, a few months ago, I was at Motor City Comic Con. My brother went into Meatloaf's line and was there about maybe 3 hours waiting to meet him. And, you know, he passed away today of COVID-19. And one of the things he was doing with people, he was taking out time to speak to everybody, take pictures. But he did tell people to take off their mask in the picture. He said it's just a flu. He said it's all BS, not a big deal. And I guess when he said, and I won't do that, he was talking about getting the vaccine. Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Well, there you go. I think that's what I didn't know the day, but I think that was Meatloaf's last public appearance was what that dude's talking about. It was the Motor City Comic Con, which I used to take my kids to every year. My daughter was heavily into Harry Potter when she was younger, and my son was into stuff too. So we would go to the Motor City Comic Con, which is actually in Novi. It's suburban Detroit. And Meatloaf's last public appearance was October. And if you saw any photos from that, by the way, he looked really thin. And he looked all of his 74 years. But if you're waiting 3 hours in line, by the way, I wonder if the sign said M-E-E-T loaf. If you waited 3 hours in line and then he said, take the mask off, I'd feel weird about that. Because, well, A, you're paying for his autograph or his photo. So it's like, bro, I'm paying you, all right? Don't tell me what to do with my face. Isn't a free photo. I'm paying you $50.
Well, I'm sure they had a situation where it was encouraged to keep the masks on. For I'm sure there was a lot of celebrities that were asking people to keep the masks on, and he was the one that was like, no, it's just the flu. Never going to get me. Or if I die, I die.
He said, if I die, I die.
I die, I die.
Hey, AJ.
Hey, guys.
Hey, what's going on?
Not much. Hey, I was just hanging out, listening to you a little bit.
Thanks, man.
I always had a kind of curious question about Meatloaf. I've seen the show they ran, you know, it was an hour and a half long, whatever the hell it was. But they never mentioned free-for-all and the work he did with Nugent.
AJ,
what happened?
AJ, what show are you talking about?
Well, it ran on, the AXT station or whatever it is.
I do not. AXS?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, they did it. You're saying they did a Meatloaf retrospective?
Yeah, right. It was at least an hour long.
Okay.
It went through his whole life, and it talked about when he was first starting out in New York City, right, maybe?
Okay.
Doing some stuff. Anyway, I waited to see if they talked about the Nugent album, and they never did. So it was always a question, and I thought maybe you guys had some knowledge of that.
Your question is what? Why
was there,
they...
Was there a falling out?
Oh, I don't know.
They never talked about it, or...
Meatloaf did... Ted Nugent did an album called Free For All, mid-70s, and Meatloaf did some vocals for that. And...
Yeah, quite a few songs.
Yeah. He did lead vocals on a couple of... Derek St. Holmes was still Ted Nugent's singer. But Meatloaf, yeah, sang a bunch of those songs. He did Street Rats and but no, I don't know. I'm not sure why they didn't mention that. Maybe it wasn't... maybe they didn't want to make that special 2 hours, AJ.
Well, I know, but I mean, it seems like... I mean, I got to know him and that music when his other albums came out. I was like, yeah, cool, because I know Meatloaf because he played with Nugent on that album, you know?
Yep. Writing on the Wall was one of the big songs.
I was never really that great of a fan, but it was cool. He was cool, right? I mean,
yeah, sure. I mean, Ted Nugent's still alive and Meatloaf's gone. Maybe, I would imagine, Ted Nugent's public comments on Meatloaf would include that.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know that I've ever seen a full program as I did. They had a Meatloaf, you know.
AJ, are you familiar with Rat Bite Fever?
I don't know that.
Very dangerous, and I want you to stay careful. Be careful and stay safe out there. Because that can be tough, too. Here's Meatloaf singing for Ted Nugent. Basically, in the 70s, every Ted Nugent song kind of sounded the same musically, so it made sense he'd bring in, like, another singer. But it also sounds like a Meatloaf song.
It's got that Meatloaf touch.
Really does. It smells like Meatloaf. I just love that the guy called himself Meatloaf.
That's so funny.
I don't need to like the music. It was fine. I never bought anything from him, but like the songs I'd hear on the radio. That was another feat, by the way, is here's a guy getting 7-minute songs played on the radio, you know, which was unheard of.
Right. 7-minute songs that are very
operatic
and Broadway-esque even.
Yeah. But to just be like, I need a stage name. What am I going to call myself? My name's Marvin. That doesn't work. Marvelous Marvin. That's a little corny. Hey, how about Meatloaf? I bet no one's out there named Meatloaf.
What?
You think so?
I don't know.
That's why I'm curious. What's that? Oh, I did, but they didn't give me mean nicknames. No. Were you given a mean nickname by your family? Ah. Oh, I see. Yeah, that word was never big with me, like in my peer group. That one never popped through. So, Meatloaf played football in high school and earned the name of ML. The nickname was ML. But when his weight increased, they started calling him Meatloaf. I don't know what ML meant.
Marvin Lee.
Oh, Marvin Lee. Yeah. Was that his name?
Yeah.
Marvin Lee. Oh, so they just started calling Meatloaf when he got fat.
Yeah. And then he's like, yeah, I'll make that my stage name.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
Hmm. Okay. Marvin Lee. Meatloaf.
We didn't really have nicknames. I mean, everybody was just kind of... Except my brother, at one point, we called him Car Wash. My younger brother, because he was... We were playing basketball one time, and he was so sweaty. And it was, we were like, oh, my God. It's like we went through the car wash.
Wait, so that one anecdote became... I guess that's all you need, right, for a nickname?
Yeah,
you just need one story.
Yeah.
Right.
We were adults. Well, he was still, I think, in high school. But, like, I was probably 22. I think I just got back from the Philippines. And we were playing basketball. And he was so sweaty. And I was like, man, it looks like you went through the car wash. And
he was like spraying sweat.
Like he was in my... But we also called him Dweeb when he was younger. So he's always been the one that's had like the tough nicknames. I was Bam Bam, available now. And then I don't think my older brothers really had any. And then my sister was just Sissy.
No. Why did she say that, Bill?
Because she's mean.
Because she's a professional comedian, that's why. Appearing at the La Jolla Comedy Store tonight. And of course, Poundcake's brother's nickname for him was just the N-word. Just something N-word, right?
That's his nickname for everybody.
Right, that's just what he called it. All right, I got to take a break here. If you want to get a text for anything, 35192. And you can listen anywhere on the iHeartRadio app.
The Alan Cox.